Well, welcome. I'm Roger Aronoff, the editor of Accuracy in Media, and welcome you all here to this press conference where we're releasing and talking about our new report from the Citizens Commission on Benghazi called Betrayal in Benghazi, a Dereliction of Duty. No one may believe this. We had no idea when we planned this that the select committee was going to be releasing theirs a day before, but that's how it turned out. So it's interesting timing, and we're happy to add more to the body of work that is explaining Benghazi. So a little background here. Accuracy in Media is the original media watchdog group founded back in 1969 by Reed Irvine. And it was very concerned about national security issues and how the media coverage affected that. And we have been involved in many national security issues through the years as a result of that. And you can read a lot about that. I'm not going to spend much time on that today, but I'm sure most of you are familiar with our work, and I hope you take a look. But from POW MIA to when Time and CNN did their Operation Tailwind story that we destroyed, that the television's Vietnam, a documentary we put on in response to a 13-part PBS series in the 80s. Anyway, we come up to now, and why did we decide to get involved in this Benghazi issue? Well, we had been watching from the sideline, as everyone had, as committee after committee took a look at this. But the problem was they were each in their own turf. There were limits of 5 minutes on each question. They didn't really seem to be getting anywhere. And you had the Accountability Review Board, which I think is pretty clearly was in the tank. It was appointed by the State Department. Hillary was never interviewed. So we decided, as we've done many times in the past, to step up. And let's take a look at this. And we came up with the idea of the Citizens Commission on Benghazi. And two of the first people I went to were up here with me today, Admiral Ace Lyons and General Tom McInerney. And I believe, if I can speak for them a little bit, I think what interested them about this was the dereliction of duty that we consider took place, particularly on the day of, but really more so than that. So as we look at this, everyone's looking for smoking guns. As a matter of fact, if you saw Dana Milbank's piece, Dana's here with us today in the today's Post. He says, where are the smoking guns? Gowdy's report, and he has quotes from Gowdy, and it makes it sound like, hey, there's no smoking guns. There's a media theme or meme out there that keeps saying, and you see this in New York Times, CNN, everywhere is saying, no new evidence of any wrongdoing by Hillary Clinton. That seems to be the conclusion of most of the media in response to yesterday. And we see a field of smoking guns, even today. Some of it's not new, but what you have here is a large puzzle, many pieces that people keep putting in, we've put in with our report 2 years ago. When we formed this back in 2013, we held an all-day conference with a number of people. Frank Wolf, who was the congressman pushing for the select committee. We had Charles Woods. We had the people from Judicial Watch who have done so much great work on this subject. Then we held a press conference in April of 2014 where we released our first report on this, and we talked about how the U.S. changed sides in the war on terror, and we laid out a narrative that we feel has been corroborated, stands to this day, and we've added a lot more to it in this new report. So I really hope you all, unlike Gowdy, you don't need to read 800 pages. If you read about 60, you'll really get the feel and the flavor of this. But we've done it in such a way We have the key findings. We have an executive summary and a table of contents, and you can get through this thing. But we, so the different aspects of this that we see, let me just mention, I mean, a couple of the smoking guns and whether they're new or not, they fit into this. For instance, we know what Hillary was telling her daughter, what she was telling the Prime Minister of Egypt, the President of Libya, on the night while the attacks were going on, and we know that they came out from their deputies' meeting and they issued a statement that night that it was about the video, the Innocence of Muslim video, and this was their theme for quite a while. Smoking gun, well, you decide. I mean, we also have the issues of how they tampered with the talking points that ended up going to Susan Rice. And it was kind of interesting yesterday. Brett Baer was interviewing Gowdy last night, and he said, well, you were prepared to, you said Susan Rice made this stuff up out of whole cloth, but when it comes to talking about Hillary Clinton, you won't say she lied. And he was very reluctant to be critical of Hillary or Obama. And this really is a scandal, as far as we're concerned, multi-level scandal of different going into Iraq, into Libya in the first place. And after our first conference, and then before, at our April 22nd, 2014 conference, one person who is here today who came to us in the meantime, Admiral Chuck Kubic. And he was an active duty admiral during the Iraq War in the early 2000s, and he retired, but he stayed in that part of the world. And he was in Libya, and he was approached by the Gaddafi regime to go to the U.S. government and say, I am prepared to negotiate my abdication under a white flag of truce. Let's not go to war. And he delivered that message and got no response back from Washington. So they were determined to go to war. Then we know about the flow of arms that was facilitated by our government, not directly supplied, but to known al-Qaeda groups. There's no question about it that this happened. And created this. I mean, Obama to this day says his biggest mistake was not preparing better for what happened in Libya after Gaddafi was gone. And today you have what we call Mad Max, really, environment in Libya, and ISIS and al-Qaeda and people going running around there. And anyway, we come to all these efforts. As we know, there were many requests, 600 or so, for more security in Libya, nearly 100 of those for Benghazi. Hillary, at her October testimony last year, said never got to her. She didn't know anything about it. Smoking gun? I don't know. Depends on how you look at it. So again, the Gowdy Committee, one of their problems was complete lack of cooperation from the White House. They have shown now the questions they've been asking, and the White House is no. You know, executive privilege, separation of powers, whatever. We're not going to tell you. We can get away with it. The media is in our pocket, basically, is what it amounts to. And that's really what's going on here. No matter what comes out, the media, the role of many in the mainstream media is to protect the legacy of President Obama and protect the presidential candidacy and viability of Hillary Clinton. And I really believe that is much of what's going on here. I wish people will read this and report on it. If there's anything wrong in it, inaccurate, tell us about it. We'll be happy to correct the record. But we think it's a penetrating analysis of what happened before, going into Libya, arms flowing to al-Qaeda, failure of security before Benghazi, the day of, this is the one that's crazy. Even today, they're saying there's no evidence that the military, even though Panetta ordered a deployment, nothing came. As Gowdy was saying, there were two drones overhead, and there was people that came in from Tripoli, but had nothing to do with being sent by the U.S. military. And so where were they? They couldn't get there in 13 hours? Well, we have people here, General McInerney, who led the raids into Libya in 1986. Admiral Ace Lyons commanded over 250,000 men at one time when he was commander-in-chief of the U.S. Pacific Fleet. So they're going to tell you what the military should have done, could have done, and it's unthinkable that they didn't. And then, of course, the cover-up, the lies that continue to this day. And we've seen it. And again, this is in large part thanks to Judicial Watch, uncovered the Rhodes memo that showed how they had politicized this process and got that going. And then, you know, it's the media. Again, big part why AIM got into this thing. But it was infuriating to see how this has unfolded. And we are adding more to this narrative, I believe, really nails it, unlike any of the other reports. But this story is not over. I mean, there is more. We have a list of questions, which is in your press kit, which we hope the journalists will use it. Let's get the answers out of the administration. We're going to continue, and we're hoping that more Admiral Kubics, more people who are on active duty today, people who have signed non-disclosure agreements, that they will come forward and tell us what they know. Because here, Charles Woods just walked in the door. Maybe get him up here a little bit later. But for right now, I'm going to turn this over to Clare Lopez with the Center for Security Policy. Woman who was in the CIA for over 20 years in many of the hot spots at the embassies while this kind of activity was going on, and she's going to give you her.
Thank you so much, Roger. Thanks to all of you for being here today and coming out to our press conference. It's been my honor to serve with Roger Aronoff and the rest of the team on the the Benghazi Citizens Commission over these last 3 years. And I also want to thank those who came forward and helped us. Admiral Kubic and so many others who stepped forward, some who can be named, some who are not named just yet, to help us to understand what happened. And I think we also owe a big tip of the hat to members of the media who really did make the effort to go out and dig up and follow the leads on this story. And among those have to be named Fox News, certainly Breitbart as well, Glenn Beck's The Blaze, especially want to give thanks and a big tip of the hat to Judicial Watch, as Roger mentioned, whose indefatigable work uncovered so much that helped us to understand what really happened in Benghazi. So when we undertook to begin this second report, we think that we bring to this this topic a willingness to name names, a willingness to assign responsibility and to demand accountability that too many of the others, committees and others, have not done, have neglected to do. And so in a way, coming this week after the Democrats of the Select Committee issued their report on Monday, and then the Republicans came out yesterday on Tuesday, and Representatives Jordan and Pompeo issued an additional views report yesterday as well. We're kind of in a cleanup batter position, I think, today. So what I'd like to do is give you an overview of our findings, which you will see, of course, in this report in a great deal more detail, but I will give you a bit of an overview right now of those things that we think the most important. If I had to put anything at the top of this list, I think it would be that we must lay blame where blame is due. Now, naturally, that blame, of course, goes to the commander-in-chief, President Barack Obama, whose absence that night is most notable above anything else. But in terms of diplomatic facilities around the world, the responsibility is with the Secretary of State, and at that time that was Hillary Clinton, to provide and ensure the safety of the Americans that she sends in harm's way to do their country's business. So this report that we have put out, the findings that that you will read in there, I think add what is most notably missing from any of the other committee reports or the ARB itself, Accountability Review Board, that Roger mentioned from the State Department. And one of the things that we assign to this entire episode, we provide an overarching narrative, I think. We connect the dots. You know, yesterday, Representative Trey Gowdy spoke before the media presenting the committee's report, and he notably refrained from assigning blame or demanding accountability by name. And he also did not draw a connection between the dots. He did not provide an overarching explanation, if you will. I think we do that in this report. And where that leads, where those dots connected lead, is that the Obama administration and the Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, Department of State, deliberately and knowingly implemented a U.S. foreign policy to aid and abet Islamic jihadists, our enemies, and in particular, across North Africa in the year of 2011 to help and aid the Muslim Brotherhood Islamic uprising to come to power in countries like Tunisia, Libya, and Egypt. No, it did not all turn out the way they may have expected in the beginning, but that was the policy, that was the intent, to help the Muslim Brotherhood to take over government of these countries. And I also think that that policy, fundamentally flawed policy, was the fundamental cause of the ultimate debacle, catastrophe, that Benghazi became in September of 2012. Now, because of the Great Purge, which took place throughout the entire United States government, 2011 till 2012, in which all presentations, all training curricula, PowerPoints, curricula, everything related to finding and naming and identifying the jihadist enemy, the global jihad enemy that we face, was purged from all training materials and from all the lexicon and official discourse across the United States government. And that means Department of State, Department of Homeland Security, Department of Justice, the military, the Pentagon, and so on, including the intelligence community. Now, because they either did not know or were not allowed to know anymore who the enemy is, the global jihad movement and all who support jihad in the fight for Sharia, that is the enemy. Because our officers were not permitted to speak of that, to know that, to pursue that, I think that had a lot to do with the policies in Benghazi specifically. And that has to do with the ability to distinguish between jihadis, Sharia-bent jihadis, like the 17 February Martyrs Brigade and Libya Shield, whom we hired, we collaborated with for our intelligence, our information, and our security at that mission in Libya. They could not distinguish or were not allowed to distinguish between jihadis like those and any in Libya who might have been genuine allies, not jihadis. Now, from Christopher Stevens to the folks at the CIA annex, they were, in fact, then relying on exactly the jihadist enemy that was eventually to turn on them and to kill four Americans and injure others so gravely. Policy of the State Department and of Hillary Clinton in particular is also deplorable, we find, that then in the early part of 2011, the Hillary Clinton State Department extended formal U.S. government recognition to the Muslim Brotherhood Revolution that was opposing at that time our ally in the war on terror, Muammar Gaddafi. He had given up his weapons of mass destruction verifiably, not with an unsigned executive agreement as has been done elsewhere, verifiably given up his WMD, given up his support for terrorism that he'd been involved in for so long before that. And he was helping us with intelligence on AQ, Al-Qaeda, in the Islamic Maghreb in particular. He had Al-Qaeda in his jails. And yet when his Muslim Brotherhood in Libya, Libyan Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda militias rose up against him, we abandoned him. We turned and we supported the enemy, his enemy and ours, the Islamic jihadist enemy. That recognition was extended to the government, the Transitional National Council, in 2011. There was a presidential intelligence finding, we are told, that allowed the U.S. agencies to provide aid and funding and weapons to those Libyan militias trying to overthrow Gaddafi. Some of that was included in our earlier report back in 2014. We go into greater detail about that here. And then, of course, in 2012, the weapons flow reversed and went out of Libya, and now it was the responsibility of the CIA and the annex team to gather up, buy back loose weapons, in particular surface-to-air missiles, and ship them out of Libya over to Turkey, and then from thence overland to, again, Muslim Brotherhood and al-Qaeda-dominated rebels in Syria fighting to overthrow Bashar al-Assad. Now, I think that the determination of the Obama administration, and particularly the Hillary Clinton State Department, to refuse all these requests for security through 2012 that we document in quite a bit of detail in our report, has to do with preserving appearances that what they had done in overthrowing Gaddafi was the right thing, and that if they had admitted that instead the country was falling into chaos, that al-Qaeda militias were running amok, that weapons were sloshing about every which way. If they had admitted that by acceding to requests for more security, it would have destroyed their narrative about the entire support for the revolution in the first place. Now, let me move quickly to something else we document in a great deal of detail in the report, and that is the abundance of warnings before the attacks of 11 September 2012. First of all, it was the anniversary of 9/11. That alone should have put U.S. forces and diplomatic missions the world over on extra alert. We know now from CIA annex security team members who have gone public now in a wonderful book, 13 Hours, and also the movie by the same name, that there was an intelligence report at least 2 weeks out before the attack of 11 September began, warning of such an attack. Furthermore, we know that there was another intelligence report that specifically talked about Ansar al-Sharia attacking potentially within the next 24 hours. This comes out on 10 September, not necessarily against the U.S. mission, but an attack was planned. Now, what happened on 9 September, that is 2 days out from the attack, was that an Egyptian TV talk show host aired a clip of the YouTube video called Innocence of Muslims. That video, really crudely produced, to be sure, was in fact not really anti-Islam at all. It contained vignettes from the life of Muhammad taken from the Sunnah and the Sirah, the biography of Muhammad. When he aired that on his show and invited outrage, Al-Azhar University responded quickly with a fatwa, and the outrage built. The embassy in Cairo knew this from social media. They did nothing. No warnings went out. No military forces were alerted to move forces perhaps closer to potential flashpoints. These are more of the warnings. And then finally, of course, the day before, this is very important, Ayman al-Zawahiri, then the head of al-Qaeda, issued a video on jihadi websites, and he called for O Sons of Libya, rise up and kill Americans because the CIA had assassinated his deputy, a Libyan, Abu Yahya Libby, some months before in the Afghanistan-Pakistan region with a drone strike. That, I have always thought, was the green light for the attack to come the next day. All of these warnings, then, ignored. No forces were moved into place. You will hear more from General McInerney and from Admiral Lyons about the authority of combatant commanders to move forces within their region under their authority. They could have done that. They did not do that. Finally, then, after ignoring all of these warnings, the attack, of course, unfolds. Now, here is a very important point, and that is that night, 11-12 September, Hillary Clinton wielded cross-border authority for Libya on behalf of the United States that night. She had the authority to give or to withhold cross-border authority for U.S. military forces to enter into Libya to rescue our people or at least attempt a rescue. Now, typically, ordinarily, the procedure is to request permission from the host government, and we were, in fact, in contact with that host government. But no request was made. The State Department issued no request to the Libyan government for cross-border authority. In fact, not until the next morning when a plane came in from Germany to pick up the survivors and the bodies of those who had fallen. So the position that we want to get across here, the point that we want to get across here is that Hillary Clinton once again was pivotal. She could have authorized the military to move. Without orders, the military cannot cross an international border, and they did not that night, and they left our people to fight and die alone the entire night. Let me finish this quickly with the cover-up afterwards that we go into in some detail. There was collusion from the very beginning at the White House level to disseminate a false narrative to blame the attack on our mission in Benghazi, which was an Islamic Jihad attack by Ansar al-Sharia and al-Qaeda affiliate, to blame that on a YouTube video. The collusion went like this, and we know this again, hat tip to Judicial Watch for getting these documents. That the White House turned immediately to Rashad Hussein, who is at that time was the administration envoy to the OIC, Organization of Islamic Cooperation, and turned to Huma Abedin, Hillary Clinton's top aide, in order to collaborate with the U.S. Muslim Brotherhood. Within 48 hours, they were all aligned in their message. They were posting, they were broadcasting, and certainly at the end of September, when all the countries meet at the United Nations for the UN General Assembly, all of the OIC presidents, prime ministers, heads of state took the podium one after the other to denounce not just the video, but to call for curbs on free speech, restrictions on free speech, because what is the number one 10-year and counting objective of the OIC, the Islamic countries of this world? It is to criminalize the criticism of Islam. Hillary Clinton, while she was Secretary of State, worked very closely with the OIC to implement their program of criminalizing criticism of Islam. When this Benghazi debacle took place, they could not resist the urge to use it as an agenda item to further this objective to curb free speech, our First Amendment rights. So let me conclude there, and of course we'll have time for your questions afterwards, but a brief overview of our report. Thank you.
Next, going to bring up Lieutenant General Tom McInerney, Air Force, retired. Tom.
Thank you, Roger. I will approach this, and thank you, Clare, for that excellent summation, and all the members who have done so well. In addition, Charles, thank you very much for being here. God bless Ty and the family. Chuck. Thank you for being here. I know you had pressing duty on the West Coast, and your mates are sorry that you're not out there to keep them out of jail. These are former Navy people that worked for them that are assuming command. And of course, Stephanie, thank you very much. I want to respond and talk about why there was no military response. Now, I'll give you my experience. I was a commander in the United Kingdom before a lot of you were born, when we attacked Gaddafi on April 15th, 1986. President Reagan ordered that attack. We attacked out of the United Kingdom because, number one, we had the appropriate airplanes that had laser-guided bombs and had the range, the F-111s, and as well as we had Margaret Thatcher. And when you have Margaret Thatcher and precision guidance bombs, you got a lot going for you. And then Ronald Reagan. So I was delighted to be the commander of that. But I really want to relate this to you because it was a pre-planned exercise, all right? We found out on a Saturday that we were going to launch on a Monday. It was after La Belle Discotheque was destroyed in Berlin, and we had two or three U.S. servicemen killed and several wounded, and the Brits, through their intelligence agency, told us it was Colonel Gaddafi. Now, so we had time to prepare, but let me give you a feel, we didn't have that much time. We're going to launch on a Monday. Our guidance was initially we would take 18 airplanes through France or take six airplanes the long way around through the Med. And the only reason I point this out is because I was given that guidance when I flew over and briefed the SYNC, General Chuck Donnelly, on a Saturday. And that night, so I had two options. That night, I was given a third option. And I told the wing commander, we only have two. He said, no, we have three. And that was 18 the long way. And here's what I want you to understand. To do that, we had to have a very large number of tankers. It turned out we had 18 KC-10s that were brand new at the time. Plus, we had about 18 KC-135s. Now, to do that, they had to download the PSYOP, the nuclear alert. President Reagan downloaded our nuclear alert on the bomber force and launched those tankers that were on 15-minute alert in the United States to fly into the United Kingdom. He executed that force, that tanker force, in 15 minutes, and where I was going to launch from two bases, all of a sudden I had four bases in the United Kingdom to launch from. That's my point I want to get across to you. We made that launch. We went out. It was done extremely well. We lost one aircraft, two crewmen. But we committed and we executed. And we didn't have a lot of time to do it. So when the President of the United States directs things to be done, they can be done. There's no question about it. Now, I met, along with the Chief of Staff of the U.S. Air Force, every air crew that landed, took off and landed. And it shows you the flexibility that we have as leaders. Now, let's get back on point. Why did we not have a military response before? Sigonella, where we have global hawks and reapers and predators, is an Italian island in the middle, about an hour from Benghazi, in the middle of the Med. So we had the UAVs there, unmanned aerial vehicles, and they should have been airborne before. They should have been airborne before. We should have pre-positioned F-16s from Aviano down to Sigonella to be on 15-minute alert, as Clare pointed out. Why? It was 9/11. Isn't 9/11 a significant date for us? And yet we had none of this preparation. We had all the combatant commanders back in Washington, D.C. on a commander's conference. Why would the Secretary of Defense bring all the combatant commanders on 9/11 back to the United States? So there was no pre-planning. I call that dereliction of duty. Next, let's go in the execution phase. All right? It happened quickly. And because we had done absolutely zero preparation, for instance, we should have had a FAST team at Sigonella as well, rather than being up in Bosnia-Herzegovina, should have been down there, because that's where the action was. As Clare pointed out, Zawahiri said we must avenge the death of al-Libi. Well, al-Libi was from Libya. Where are they going to avenge the death? Not in San Bernardino. And we knew the instability that we had at Benghazi. The State Department had missed that. So we had no pre-planned activity. And then even, let's say, the start that they were given, they still could have launched F-16s. We've had to go with four tanks, no bombs. All they needed was 20 millimeter, which they always have on board, whether it's training material or training weapons or API, armored piercing incendiary. No matter what it was, they always have that on board because it's a ballast problem. And all they had to do was launch every 30 minutes two aircraft, take off, go down, punch your tanks, make a low pass over Benghazi, come back out, land at Sigonella. By then, we should have had tankers. But nothing moved. The president said, support this fight. And they did nothing. Nothing got airborne except two UAVs that were out of Sigonella that one and then followed by another. That was all we did, the most powerful military in the world. And we should have been able to at least fly by. If you go by Benghazi and go low at night, full afterburner, they don't know whether you've got laser-guided bombs or what you've got. But we know from our experiences in both Afghanistan and Iraq, when you do make a low pass like that, they disappear. So we've had that combat experience. We did nothing. Now, the troubling part is no other military active duty people are getting up and saying that. They've signed non-disclosure agreements, and that means the administration to this day is terrified that the real story on Benghazi will come out about the dereliction of duty and then a cover-up. But this is bigger than Watergate. Watergate was confined to the Oval Office. This goes right to two directors of the CIA, two chairmen of Joint Chiefs of Staff, both foremen now, two former Secretary of Defenses, two Secretaries of State, Attorney Generals, two of them, all have been covering this up. Never in the history of the United States have we seen a cover-up like this. And the cover-up is led none other than by who? Not the administration, by our mainstream media that will not present these facts, helped by our Congress. I respect Trey Gowdy, but I'm very worried that that report that he put out, and Chuck explained maybe the method of his madness, but the fact is he should have come up with some conclusions. Now, we can read an 800-page report and come up with conclusions if you can get through page 8. So we're humans. So the American people want to know, for a group that spent almost 2 years on it, what the conclusions were. That's what we pay you for, Mr. Gowdy. All right. So we had dereliction of duty by the president, the vice president, the National Security Council, Sec State, Sec Def, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the combatant commanders, et cetera. I know this because 1 month after this happened, a young Navy lieutenant approached me at the golf course at Army Navy and wouldn't give me his name. He said, keep doing what you're doing, General. I was in the Situation Room that night. And has anybody seen a picture of the president and his national security team on the front page of the Wall Street Journal like we have for when he took Osama bin Laden down? Where was the president? And that complicit media is doing a great, great injustice against the United States of America. Charles, thank you very much for being here. God bless you. God bless you all for being here.
We'll hear more from everyone during Q Q&A, and we'll have discussion afterwards. Right now, I want to bring up another member of our commission, Lieutenant Colonel Denny Haney. Denny has become our sort of interlocutor with the 13 Hours guys, the ones who wrote the book and were in the movie and spent many hours with them. And so we want to talk about, was there a stand down order or not? And what are we talking about? Are we talking about that night in Benghazi from telling them not to go from the CIA annex to the special mission compound? Are we talking about stand down, not to go bring the military assets to bear during the attack? So I want Denny to come up and talk about that. I think you'll get to know Denny here. Come on.
Roger and I have done this before, so he's well aware of what you're getting into. My name's Dennis Haney. I am a Lieutenant Colonel in the United States Air Force, retired. I'm a wild weasel bear. And if you want to know what anything about me, just Google Dennis Haney, wild weasel, and you will find my stuff in the Smithsonian. No, just kidding. You'll actually find it in the National Museum of the United States Air Force, some of my stuff from my combat tours there. So that was my war. That was our war, General McInerney's war, Admiral Lyons' war. You know, we've got these four named people out there, Hillary, Diane, Rodham, Clinton. We've got Barack, Hussein, Sotaro, Obama. And what's with these four names anyway? The only one I call by four names is Admiral James Ace Lyons. And that's because his first name is Admiral to me. And I'm here to talk about the 13 Hours guys. They're operators. We had a Special Forces Colonel, Lieutenant Colonel, now Colonel, Andy Wood, who was very helpful to our committee, to our commission. He was also very helpful to a lot of the committees. If any of them paid any attention to him whatsoever, he was right up there telling the truth. He's a reservist in Special Forces. He was in Benghazi, or rather, he was in Tripoli. He used to run with Ambassador Stevens every morning. He used to have breakfast with him right afterwards, and they knew each other very well. And he knew they needed support there, and so did the ambassador. He really needed it a lot. And Colonel Wood, I say that because he's an operator, like the three operators I'm about ready to get into. He said that he told me that he had asked twice to be kept at the Libya, specifically in any area that he could be going to, Tripoli or Benghazi, with a 16-man Special Forces team, and twice he was told no, he was leaving. He was actually there on other business than Benghazi. And his replacement came in, and he left on the 1st or 31st of August, and you know what happened thereafter. The 13-hour guys, if you've seen them, read the book. That's the definitive thing. See the movie. And by the way, buy the CD set. There's seven CDs, and I played them till they wore out. Excellent. And in that movie, a very telling scene right at the end of the movie just overwhelmed me. I had been through the book and the CDs seven different times. I knew the story inside and out. I talked to these guys over breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and as far away from everything we could get in Montana together, going shooting. The things they told me correspond to anything you've heard them say. I mean, you know, and you look these guys in the eye as one operator to another, and you know they're telling the truth. They've got to tell the truth because, as General McInerney, Admiral Lyons, and I, and Admiral Kubic, we all know that you depend on that other guy, and that's why you're there, is for that other guy. So three guys came forward out of the five remaining. Ty Woods was dead. Glenn Dougherty was a GRS, Global Response Staff person, that came in from Tripoli. He brought in two Delta Force, three other GRS operators, and a translator that crammed into a oil executive's jet and went to Benghazi. That, by the way, was the only airborne approach into Benghazi. So I'll talk to you a little bit. One of the things that I was really interested in is they've gotten a rough shake out of the previous committees they've appeared before, specifically Representative Mike Rogers' House Select Committee, Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence. They had a report, and basically they said, you know, no problem here. Hillary didn't do anything wrong. And oh, by the way, this is what the operator said. What the operator said was the truth. But if you read that report, there are 14 instances in it, in Representative Rogers' report. By the way, that was written by Mike Rogers and Dutch Ruppersberger. No one else wrote it, Democrat or Republican. No Republican signed it except for Representative Rogers. And I'm here to tell you it's got 14 egregious errors in it, and I will be glad to give those to anybody that comes up and gives my business card afterwards. I'll be glad to tell you exactly what happened. So that's a pack, as far as the operators went, that's a pack of lies. Lies and misstatements, and I would say obfuscations would be the polite way of putting it. You know, I bet you didn't know a guy that flew fighters could say that, right? Much less understood. I think I understood it. Got to check with the Admiral Lyons on that one. So we can blow off the House Permanent Select Committee and anything that Representative Rogers says. And I will tell you that throughout the Democrats' version that they put out the day before Trey Gowdy put out his report, it's rife with information about the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence. And you know, I guarantee you that is a bad, bad source. And you can quote me on it as much as you want to, and I'll back it up 100%. Specifically, I asked the three operators from Tripoli, Global Response Staff, CIA, Annex Security Team operators, and I asked them, tell me what's wrong with what's in here. And they said, go to TIG, John Tig Tiggin. TIG came to me with all the information I needed, and I've got it anytime you want it. They put out an article for one of the online news sources. They got it wrong, so come to me for the true word. The next statement is, was there a stand-down order? There was a stand-down. The word stand-down, we're told, to John Tig Tiggin. That's a fact. You can take that one to the bank. They were told to him by Benghazi Bob. That's what I call him. He's the senior CIA guy at Benghazi. And Claire knows all about that sort of stuff. But at any rate, he told them that. He told John Tegan those two words. Cristiano Pirano heard him say to John Tegan, stand down. What Benghazi Bob told Tonto and Oz were directly to their face, do not go. That's what he said. There's an administration, before I even really got involved with this, I'm from Special Operations Speaks, and as such, thanks to nomination from another air superiority individual on the CCB, I'm here as an Air Force person. But at any rate, what they said was there were two guys that appeared on TV, one rather narrow and one rather rotund, was larger than this, and the other guy, you couldn't see him. But at any rate, it's the height of bureaucraties. He stated they were not told to stand down. They were told not to go. Like there's a difference. Now, Benghazi Bob in January came out and said, we've got, there was no stand down order. Look very carefully at his words and his write-up. It says stand down order. And he can get away with saying that because he can say, okay, I didn't give a stand down order. He didn't say stand down. Remember that. That's a bureaucrat talking who was about ready to retire. So lots to go on here. Sorry, I'm getting two different calls to wrap it up here. And I'm on statement one. Okay, get more time in QA. Okay, we got that. Okay, fine. No evidence to substantiate CIA was collecting or shipping arms from Libya. Okay, we'll just leave that one at that, except Boehner lied to Brett Baer on the 20th of October, 2 days before Hillary lied four times under oath to Representative Pompeo. They talk about the timing. As far as that goes, there really wasn't enough time. There was plenty of time, 20 minutes. And they were saying 15 minutes to get those guys ready. They were up, running, and ready, geared up, jocked up, as they called it. They were ready to go. And they could have been there in time to protect, or not only protect, but to save the ambassador and Sean Smith. I talked to Sean Smith's uncle this morning, and he said he's read our report. He got halfway through his report. He got all the way through our board. And he says, read this report if you want to know the truth. And that's what I will say. If you want to be able to cogently understand what the heck went on, read that. When Hillary said that the GRS guys were her first line of defense there for her people, she was mistaken, or lied, or didn't know what she was talking about. Take your pick. All three are bad, by the way. And they were there working for the CIA and the CIA only. There are no Jason Bournes in CIA at the operational level like at Benghazi. Those guys were probably checked out in arms, but they weren't on the roof. Nobody had a rifle up on the roof. They were all inside building 19. Where was the building C? I keep forgetting. So like they said, the only thing that's good about this report on the Democrat side is the cover. It's got a picture of four operators going. I like that picture. The rest of it is, well, bullshit. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dennis. Well, you're getting a feel for the collection of people that make up the Citizens Commission on Benghazi. In the back of this, and it's also on the website, you have a couple pages with bios and pictures of everybody. Hope you, if you go online, aim.org/Benghazi, there are more detailed biographies of everybody, and I think you ought to take a look. We've got several other generals, colonels, as he mentioned, Special Operations Speaks, the three founding members are all part of our commission, Alan West. So it's quite a group. Charles Woods, you want to come? Going to bring up Charles Woods, father of Ty Woods, is going to say a few things. And Charles, great to see you.
First of all, I just want to, and I know that's for Ty and for the rest of the ones who perished. Thank you. As a father, my concern was my son and the rest would be still alive if there'd been any attempt whatsoever made at a rescue. Many, many times, Ty, as a Navy SEAL in his 20 years of service, was in worse situations than this. But he always knew that if there was a compromise of the mission, that he was going to be extracted. That did not happen in this case. That's part of the DNA of being in the military. That's part of the code of ethics, is you are always rescued. That didn't happen here. I wanted to find out who made the decision not to rescue and why that decision was made. The problem being is that stories keep changing. And what's happened here is that the principal parties, we're talking the Secretary of State, we're talking about Panetta, we're talking about General Hamm, have all changed their stories multiple times. Just to give one example, Jason Chaffetz, in October, he went back to Libya with General Hamm, head of AFRICOM. And General Hamm said at that time, on three different occasions, that he had military assets immediately available in the area, but he was never authorized to use them. Now, I could hardly wait to read that testimony. And finally, I saw the transcript. He testified several times. And Jason Chaffetz, who's an honorable member of the House of Representatives, at the final meeting, when he is testifying under oath, said to General Hamm, I have met you on three different occasions, and on three different occasions, you've given me different stories. And the problem is, all of these witnesses did exactly the same thing. They changed their stories. Now, I'm a retired attorney, and there's a rule of law in the courtroom that if the testimony of an individual is false in one respect, their entire testimony is to be disregarded. And that's the problem with the Secretary of State and these other people. Their testimony continues to change. Which story do we believe? The first story, the second story, the third story, or none at all? And that's the frustration that the committee had, was that they couldn't believe anyone, so they had to rely upon the documents. Documents normally don't lie. And the problem was the administration has either destroyed those documents, withheld those documents, or failed to produce them. And so we really, I don't have closure as far as to who made the decision not to rescue. Obviously, we have an expert here. We have a lot of experts in the military that say they could have been rescued. No attempt was made. Mention was made of the Democratic report that came out, and quite frankly, there was one point that I really did agree with. It said, quote unquote, the State Department's security measures were woefully inadequate. I agree with that. Who's the State Department? Hillary Clinton. If Hillary Clinton could not protect the 35 Americans under her control in Benghazi, how does she think that she could possibly provide for the security of 300 plus million Americans here in our country? Thank you.
Next, I'm going to bring up a true force of nature, 88-year-old retired Admiral James Ace Lyons.
Thank you, Roger. Thank you all for coming today. And I've got to thank you, Charles. You took my closing line. But that's right on target.
You have trouble hearing me?
Yeah.
Let me say, you know, when I first heard of Benghazi, my initial reaction was, this is un-American. This is not us. This is not the way we respond. And, you know, when I watched the press conference yesterday, I was not, to say I was disappointed would be an understatement, because Chairman Gowdy is not a stenographer and he's not a tape recorder. He was there to make findings and conclusions. He had the information. He copped out, which is consistent that we've seen with all our congressional leadership. We don't have any. Now, you've heard from Clare and everybody, Benghazi never had to happen. Libya never had to happen. As you heard, our good friend Chuck Kubic, who was involved in the truce negotiations. And here we have a president who received the Nobel Peace Prize for giving a speech. But he couldn't give 3 days to avoid tens of thousands of lives being lost when Gaddafi was ready to abdicate. So you have to wonder who stepped in there and prevented that. Now, I want to go over a few things. And for you reporters, I want you to put yourself in a different position. I want you all to take a position that you're with Ambassador Stevens on his trip to Benghazi. And you, as Americans, what you would expect from us on how to respond.
Now, you know, the security situation in Benghazi was out of control. You had at least 10 militias running wild. The government in Tripoli said, we have no control. Yet, all of Ambassador Stevens' requests for increased security were not only denied, but security assets we had in country were drawn down. Now, does this make any sense? Of course, the excuse that's thrown out is that this didn't fit the political agenda and might have impacted adversely on President Obama's re-election campaign. Well, I don't buy any of that. Who in the hell is going to know if I put six more Department of State security people on Ambassador Stevens' team in Tripoli and Benghazi? Who? Who is going to know if I delay the departure of Lieutenant Colonel Andy Woods' special security team from departing Tripoli on 16 August to 16 September? Nobody. This is all nonsense. So, here we go. On the 29th of August, the Tripoli governor, the deputy prime minister, puts out an alert. He puts Benghazi on a special alert status because of the out-of-control security situation. Bells should have went off everywhere. I got to tell you, as a former commander-in-chief, if it's my area of responsibility, I'm not even waiting. I'm pre-positioning forces. That's what I'm supposed to do. That's what's expected of me. There's no reason why F-16 aircraft weren't moved from Aviano to Sigonella or to Suda Bay, Crete, either places. We had a 130-man Marine Force recon team at Sigonella. We had the Marine FAST teams at Rota. We had the Commanders and Extremist Force in Croatia. We had assets. Now, what you don't find in the report, I've got to say, we have competent military leaders. And I got to tell you, I am sure that they probably would have moved to pre-positioned forces. I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. They were prevented. I don't know that. But my gut tells me we have professional people. They would have done that. So, we know we had, that's almost 2 weeks advance notice of the situation. We had 10 days advance notice there was going to be attacks in Benghazi. 10 days. And this is verified by our GRS wonderful fighters at the CIA annex. They sign that notification each and every day. And then they took it down, and regretfully, they shredded the damn thing. I wish I could show it to you. But nonetheless, their word is 24-karat gold. Now, there's one other thing I want to throw out. I talked to Lieutenant Colonel Andy Wood. And I said, Andy, did you ever participate in the escape plans? And he said, yes, I did. I said, well, run through for me what's the key elements. If they came under attack, you would hierarchy the ambassador into the safe house, and you unlocked the barred windows from the inside, and outside that window was to be a car. You got the ambassador out in the car over to the CIA annex. Sound reasonable? What happened the night of the attack? Guess what? No car. Whose responsibility was it to have that car there? I don't know if the Gowdy report identifies that. I haven't read the 800 blibbit pages yet, but I will. And you know, there's one other thing I want to mention. When that special mission compound was open, the Department of State did an internal security analysis. And the bottom line was, beef up the security or close it. You know what happened. So, you want me to wrap it up, I take it. All right. Well, so here we have the day of the attack. And I can just, you're there. You're with Stevens in that compound. And you're told you're waiting for the Americans to come rescue you. You can't believe it. Nobody's coming. And I got to say, Tonto and the guys were the only ones that really could have saved the ambassador, had they been allowed to go. Not being, delaying them 30 minutes cost two lives. And you have to, you know, you can't walk this back. It is what it is. And also, I've got to say that the response that came out was really less than helpful. Now, we know that Secretary Panetta gave the orders to deploy forces, not to preposition, but to deploy forces. It's in the report. Thanks to Stephanie pointing that out to me.
I actually read the report.
All under 800 pages. Now, who countermanded those orders, in effect? We know Jeremy Bash, the chief of staff of the Department of Defense, at 1910 that evening, sent an email or called the State Department and said, we're spinning up as we talk. Where do we get the cross-border authority? He's still waiting for that answer. So this is more than just dereliction of duty. It's more than incompetence. We just don't do this to Americans. Now, I want to just touch on one other thing. Everybody involved in this operation has had to sign non-disclosure agreements, which are in effect today. That's why we haven't been able to get anybody to come forward and talk about this. You have to ask yourself why. Where was the president the night of this attack? Well, the one place you know he was not was in the Situation Room, because if he was there, You'd have that information. You'd have the photograph, just like you had the photographs yesterday of him in the Situation Room with the terrorist attack in Istanbul. So who was running the show? The bottom line is really the one responsible was Hillary Clinton. Who put all the obstacles up to prevent the movement of the forces? And I got to tell you, as a commander, I can pre-position forces anywhere in my area of responsibility. I don't need authority from Washington to do that. That never happened. And one last thing I want to know. We haven't been able to talk to those drone controllers, but I've often wondered, in our coverage of the CIA annex, did that photography pick up the mortars? The mortars, which then, in my view, what should have happened is that drone should have been crashed right into the mortar, and we'd have two less casualties. And I think, before Roger falls out of the chair, I better stop here, and we open it up to your questions.
Right. Okay. All right, well, let's just get started, and then let's see where this goes. Yes.
Hi, I'm Penny Starr with CNS News. So you've all said that the Gowdy, the Select Committee report, did not draw conclusions. Can you expand on why you think that happened, and if there can still be conclusions drawn, or was that $1.7 million in all that time just...
$7 million, yeah.
$7 million.
Tom, you want to take that one?
Well, I think he had his reasons, political, just like everything. My take is we hired him to do this, and it's a complex issue, and that he should have had conclusions, and so I'm openly critical of them. Now, I do believe that part of the problem is the Republican leadership, along with the Democratic leadership, had approved the black operations that were going on that Clare mentioned about weapons going from Benghazi to Turkey into Syria, and she says radical Islamists or Al-Qaeda-like ISIS. We built up ISIS forces with those weapons, along with others, and none of them want to admit because they were about that high in those days, and so the administration thought that they could help take down Bashar al-Assad. But the fact is we helped create ISIS. And I think that's the dirty little secret that nobody wants out. And because Boehner had approved it, McConnell had approved it, Rogers had approved it, but the Big Six had all approved it. But that isn't the issue. The issue is, why didn't we try to help Americans? That would have not exposed that black operation at all if we would have responded and saved those, at least two of them. But for whatever reason, the president decided not to. Despite what he says, the president is the one that decided not to. And everybody else has backed him. And as Ace said, this is not the America that we know. Clare?
Anyone else?
I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Next. Yes, sir.
I'm John Malloy, Chair of National Vietnam and Gulf War Veterans Coalition. I have a couple of different questions. One is, every time I hear Mike Rogers with something to think about, I was made aware that his wife was responsible for the security at the Benghazi mission, and he, as head of the Intelligence Committee, has been given cover and consequently resigned. So I suspect that he's complicit also in this cover-up.
Let me get Clare to take that. And why don't you talk about a little of the security
sure.
at the
Special Commission. You're referring, I'm sure, to the Aegis company. The parent company, Aegis LLC, headquartered in London. The American subdivision of that was headed by Christy Rogers, and it was called Aegis Defense Solutions. And that American subsidiary, yes, won a very large contract to provide worldwide security at U.S. diplomatic missions and other elements of that contract award. But Aegis did not itself provide directly the security in Benghazi. Subsidiaries and those who were subprime contractors received some of that work. It wasn't Aegis per se, but some of the subcontractors, to include Blue Mountain, for example, received that contract. And here's where I think blame does lie, and that is that when Blue Mountain went into Benghazi in 2012 and won part of that Protection Services Award, they, again, just like the rest of the U.S. government, had no clue who was whom in the brew of jihadist militias there, or had any idea how to select security guards on the basis of whether they would be jihadis or not jihadis. And therefore, Blue Mountain wound up hiring people, security people for our mission, the ambassador's compound, and as well the U.S. government and the annex also relied on militias like the February 17 Martyrs Brigade. Martyrs Brigade. Does this ring a bell with anybody? That the name itself should have set off alarm bells. But again, because nobody was allowed to understand, to know the connection between Islamic doctrine, law, and scripture and Islamic terror, the words jihad and sharia and caliphate were all purged from the lexicon. They hired the very people, the very jihadis, to guard our mission who were our enemies. That's the bottom line on that.
Dana?
Thanks.
Dana Milbank, go ahead.
Could I just press you all a little more on the Gowdy committee? Is the concern that he pulled his punches, that there was more information they didn't put in the report, or is it more a question of the information's there but not the conclusions?
I think the information. Well, go ahead, Ace.
No, I think the information was there, and that the why the conclusions were not made is a question that we've raised. The information was there. So I think you, again, it's, let me tell you know, you got to have a lot of backbone and guts in this town, which you well know. And, you know, when you put yourself on the line, you got to be willing to stand up and be held accountable. Regretfully, I don't think he measured up yesterday.
Yeah, I just would say that.
Stephanie had a question.
Oh, okay. Well, I was going to finish answering that and just make another point about that. Is that, yeah, they didn't give the story enough context, and that's what we feel we've done here. What took us into Libya in the first place? What happened with these arms flowing there? Why were we there? And then the other parts of the story, the failures of the security, what was the reasoning? And so they didn't, they put a bunch of transcripts in there, interviews, but they didn't weave it all together in a narrative that explains everything. And that, I think, is the problem with it. You agree?
Yeah, no, I do agree. They did not draw the narrative the way we drew it. And I think if you read this report, you will see a narrative that is cohesive, very thoroughly referenced.
Stephanie.
Stephanie Jason. I have a follow-up question to one that was just asked. I actually read the full report, and it's very informative, and I really do think everyone must read it in detail. All the facts are there. But what I found interesting was the passages that talk about the meeting in the White House at 7:30 that the Secretary Clinton participated in, it doesn't even say her name. It just says Secretary. Everyone else in the report is named individually with their title. They don't do that with her. They just call her Secretary, and you have to figure out that they're talking about Secretary Clinton because then they preference it with Department of State before everything else. So when I'm watching this unfold yesterday and reading this, I'm almost wondering if has someone in the GOP leadership gotten their fingers involved in watering down some of this against Secretary Clinton? And it leads me to believe that this is a similar instance where the House Judiciary Committee passed a bill to ban the Muslim Brotherhood in America, in American soil, but the GOP leadership is preventing that from going to a vote. I wonder if you could comment on that.
Penetration by the Muslim Brotherhood of the top ranks of United States government, national security, as well as academia, media, and society at large, is massive. It has been going on for many decades, goes back to the years right after World War II, as a matter of fact, to begin with. And so, yes, the influence of the Brotherhood, certainly on Obama foreign policy, but the policy of presidents before him as well, having to do with Middle East policy, policy towards Islam, policy towards the Brotherhood itself, certainly is strongly influenced by the presence of advisors and appointees at the top ranks of the United States government and national security. And I think, as we mentioned in the report too, this is part of the narrative we have drawn, part of the reason for the Obama White House policy to encourage the Islamic uprising of 2011 and their takeover as anticipated, not as it turned out necessarily, but as they wanted and anticipated in Tunisia and Libya and Egypt. As far as that bill that is in Congress, it is sponsored by Senator Ted Cruz, if I'm not mistaken, and it is a sense of the Senate kind of a resolution to urge the designation of the Muslim Brotherhood as a foreign terrorist organization. And it does, as you say, languish currently as we speak. It'll have to pass a number of hurdles to become policy. But the State Department governs the naming of organizations to the foreign terrorist organizations list.
Someone else. Go ahead. Yes. You want to identify yourself?
I'm with military.com. Much has been made of the delays in getting the Marine FAST team out to Libya. And since you have this report and you've got these retired general officers on the panel, I was curious to hear your thoughts of, you know, since the FAST team was not pre-positioned, since it was in Rota, when would the order to deploy have to come? When would they have had to leave to make any kind of real difference on the ground?
One of you, gentlemen.
Well, I think at the time that when Secretary Panadas gave the order to deploy the forces, that's what probably triggered them at that point. They should have been alerted before that, certainly with the out-of-control security situation, with the warning that was given on the 29th of August that Benghazi had to be put on a special alert status. So, you know, this is not PhD stuff. This is common sense. You do what you have to do. And regretfully, it wasn't done. What I haven't found is why wasn't it done? Because it's really a dereliction of duty.
If I might add to that just a bit, Secretary Panetta gave the order for the FAST teams in Rota to deploy, to move to at least down to Sigonella, if not onward to Benghazi, at about 2 a.m. in the morning. That would be local time. Unfortunately, those teams had to wait until, if I recall correctly, but double check me in the report, something like 8 a.m. the following morning or later for a plane to come from Germany to pick them up and transport them, in the midst of which they had to receive conflicting orders about what clothing to wear, uniforms or civvies, and they changed in and out of their clothing multiple times through the night, according to changing orders coming from somewhere above. But in any case, the plane that they needed to take them anywhere never got to them until the following morning, by the which time everything was over, and in the end, they wound up traveling to Tripoli rather than Benghazi.
Well, there were two teams. One was supposed to go to Tripoli, and the other one was supposed to go to Benghazi. The one to Benghazi got canceled. And, of course, you have to ask why. They should have went in there, secured the facility, just and so like all the CNN reporters and everybody else went in there and found Ambassador Stevens' memo and so forth, and it took the FBI another 3.5 weeks to get there. You know, come on.
So if they had been able to deploy within the hour of 2 a.m. From Rota, Spain, do you think they could have arrived in time to save any American lives?
I'm not sure if the FAST teams would have been able to make a difference, even for the two whose lives were lost at the very end of the night with a mortar attack. But other assets, as the Admiral talked about earlier, the F-16 certainly could have gotten there well in advance and in time enough to make a difference. But again, it was that cross-border authority that was withheld. Secretary of State Clinton preferred to defend a re-election campaign above defending American lives that night.
Yeah, all right. I'm sorry. Can we get to everybody? Yeah, okay.
I have a quick question. It's about Ahmed Abu Qatala. And a lot of people seem to overlook the man who was brought to the United States as one of the leaders of the Benghazi attack. It's my understanding that Qatala was a brigade commander for the rebels during the revolution, which our government armed, aided, and abetted as a part of the Libya revolution. He executed the leadership of the attack in Benghazi, was subsequently taken from Libya by our forces, brought back to the United States. Now, my question is this. Doesn't that tie the revolution and the actions of the administration during the revolution to aid and abet the enemy to an attack, killing the lives of brave Americans, attacking our facilities directly, a terrorist attack? And furthermore, he was abducted by our forces back in 2014. Why hasn't he gone to trial? He will not go to trial until September 2017, conveniently after the election. What is going on?
Yeah, Abu Qatala, just as you say, Stefan, exactly, was the commander of a smallish jihadist militia that fought against the regime of Muammar Gaddafi in 2011. By 2012, his group, like other militias, had folded into the newly created umbrella group of Ansar al-Sharia, which before 2012 had not been established in Libya. So now his militia is part of that bigger group, Ansar al-Sharia, including many other jihadi groups across Libya. And so, yes, I don't know if any of the aid that the United States or NATO permitted through the barricades, the blockade in 2011, if any of those weapons, most of which came from Qatar, actually supplied Abu Qatala's militia or not. We don't know that information. But certainly Gaddafi would never have been overthrown if the Western powers hadn't intervened. So now he's part of Ansar al-Sharia in 2012. He did not apparently play a large role in the attack on our mission in September 2012, but he has been placed at the scene, and yes, he was picked up and brought to the States ostensibly for trial. Andy McCarthy, the brilliant former Department of Justice prosecutor in the Blind Sheikh case back in 1995, has written about this and many other things. By the way, he testified brilliantly yesterday on Capitol Hill at Ted Cruz's, Senator Ted Cruz's committee hearing on Islam and Jihad. But Andy has written about this very case, and here's an interesting point. If indeed the attack on our mission in Benghazi was due to some video and mobs that were protesting and got out of control, well, then how can you possibly prosecute a guy, charge him, indict him, prosecute him, like Abu Qatala, for being a mastermind of a terror attack on our mission at the same time? It just doesn't compute. So I can understand the U.S. government prosecution might be in something of disarray.
Cliff.
I have a two-pronged question. The refrain we hear from the media is, oh, there's nothing new here, nothing new in the Gowdy report. Is there anything new here? And moreover, is the Obama administration policy of supporting jihadists or terrorists in the Middle East continuing? We just saw this explosion and attack in Turkey. We know the administration is openly acknowledging sending arms to an affiliate of the PKK, a notorious terrorist group that has been bombing Turkey and killing thousands of people for years. What about that policy? Have they not learned anything? Or is it just continuing because we don't learn the lessons and don't refer to these people in charge as what they are? And finally, the uncle of Sean Smith on Fox News this morning was asked point blank. He said, this report you have is much better than the Gowdy report, but he got to the nub of it, going way beyond what you've said. He says Clinton and Obama are criminals.
Yes.
They're traitors. He said that on the air. What do you think?
They are.
Yeah.
Cliff, if I may corroborate that, Mike called me after he did that this morning, and he said those exact same words.
You know, Cliff, the policy as we define it, and again, I do think this is the value of this report, that we weave together, we connect the dots, and we tell the narrative and why it happened, not just a sequence of date and time and events. But why it happened, and why it happened gets to your question. The policy of the Obama administration and the Hillary Clinton State Department was to support, enable, aid, and abet Islamic jihadis, in particular the Muslim Brotherhood, both domestically and abroad. Yes, that policy continues. And so the events in Libya are a part of that, a critical part, and one of those places where American lives were lost because of that policy. And because, again, the priority of defending a president's re-election campaign took priority over defending the lives of American citizens in danger.
What about, can I ask you, though, to comment, you were in the CIA, what about this open policy now of supporting this PKK affiliate, affiliated with the Kurdistan Workers' Party, an old KGB creation? Do you defend that?
I don't speak for the CIA, and I had nothing to do with the Middle East when I was serving in any case, but you're referring to the hodgepodge, really, of different militia groups over in the Middle East battle space right now, the PKK, the Turkish Workers' Party, as you say, with communist roots, has been fighting against the Turkish government for a very long time. But the problem is that its affiliates, its Kurdish partners, inside of the former Syria, including the YPG and other groups there, are some of the most effective fighters in the field against the Islamic State, which provides puts up a conundrum. People want to defeat the Islamic State. By the way, I don't know why they don't want to defeat the equally jihadist regime in Tehran at the same time and its satellite puppet regimes in Damascus and Baghdad, but that might be a separate question. But the problem is that the Kurds, the Peshmerga, those who face death, have proven to be some of the most effective fighters in that battle space. And so where do you draw the line on whom to assist and back and help when the objective seems to be single-mindedly, rather tunnel vision, if I might say so, to take down the Islamic State without ever considering the other jihadis in the battle space. It's a very confusing situation.
So let me ask Admiral Kubic a minute, based on this question. What in the new report, the Gowdy report, and you've read our report, what connects them? What do you find new in there? Why don't you step up? This is Admiral Chuck Kubic, who I mentioned before, was the man who tried to be the intermediary in the sort of aborted negotiations for Gaddafi's abdication.
By the way, if you haven't read the Accuracy in Media, CCB's report, it's really an easy read because it's done in a narrative style. Although it's investigative, it has the facts and everything, it reads like a novel. I mean, it's a well-written bad novel. You know?
Good novel?
Well,
good
novel, it's right. Story. Exactly. And also, if I might say, again, a first impression about the Gowdy report, and I think as people read into it and particularly read his cover letter and listen to what he's saying, is that he saw as his job, I think, I'm just interpreting what I see, to lay out the facts not only in a story form or as an investigation, but document the facts with either documents or sworn testimony and transcripts, which he hopes to eventually release. And in doing that, he said that he, number one, felt an obligation to the four Americans who lost their lives to tell the story, to put the facts out there. He also felt like it was important for the American people to understand the truth. And he also points out that there are unanswered questions because of questions that they've asked to the White House in particular that they haven't received an answer. So he kind of, at the end, leaves it open that there are still some unanswered questions. But his main point is that he's laid out the facts, and he's asking the American people. He's asking the journalist. He particularly asked all the members of Congress to read the report. As Stephanie says, you can read it in one very focused day, and to then draw your own conclusions. Because I think the one thing that that he and the other members of the committee, felt, they have an undying respect for the American people, and that the American people can handle the truth no matter how difficult it is. And once they know the truth, they will be able to do the right thing, based on the facts as they see them. And that may lead to a debate. We're seeing it now in the different reports, and we've seen now a commentary being put out that is more narrative. But I think that that's really the challenge that Chairman Gowdy has put forth, is to read it, look at the facts yourself, connect the dots. To Roger's question, the one thing that jumped out at me, because I knew a lot of the information. When people say it's not new, well, we've been talking about it. Some of us have been inputting the information. Some of us lived it. There was, something new. And as I hearken back when I was here 2 years ago, I spoke as a member of the panel, and I talked about my efforts at the onset of the war, specifically starting on March 19th, 2011, working actually with business colleagues who were talking with, military, not with necessarily Gaddafi, his sons, the regime, but military officers who were basically looking for a way to encourage the abdication of Gaddafi, and basically wanted a ceasefire to be able to negotiate that. And we basically worked through a 72-hour truce. We had basically the conditions of the truce laid out, agreed to. There had been shows of good faith on both parties. And this was going to be between opposing military commanders pursuant to the law of war under a white flag. And we had everything worked out over 3 days of very, active back and forth negotiation through intermediaries, working with Africa Command and with the military that was immediately around Gaddafi. And we got to the point on the 22nd of March where everything was set except for exactly when it was going to be and whether we would hold the talks afloat on a ship, either off the coast or in the harbor, or ashore on the former U.S. air base at Wheelis Air Base, which is right there in Tripoli. When I was trying to work those details, I was told that it was called off. And I asked to speak with General Hamm, because we were very, very close to stopping the fighting. And they told me it wasn't General Hamm that made the decision. I said, well, I'm here in Virginia. I'm headed to the Pentagon. Who do I need to talk to? They said, wasn't the Pentagon. And so, and I said, well, I need to do something. And they said, Admiral, we recommend you just let it go. And I found out, eventually, that it was Secretary Clinton working directly with the Joint Chiefs of Staff who had shut down not that truce talk, but it shut down a parallel one that I didn't even know was happening through a different, business channel. What was new in the report this time that I never knew about the 7:30 White House meeting that happened between the meeting where Secretary Panetta met with the president at 5 o'clock, and we knew that there was a communication between Secretary Clinton and the president at 10 o'clock. Didn't know about the 7:30 meeting. And there's lots being talked about that and the action items that came after it. But the one thing that struck me was it was a deputy's meeting, but Secretary Clinton was participating. And in her participation, she fundamentally obstructed the direct order of the commander-in-chief, because President Obama had ordered the Secretary of Defense to launch a rescue mission, do whatever is necessary. The Secretary of Defense had given not a be prepared to order, not a warning order, he had given an execute order. And when they went to talk about that, there was a whole series of obstacles that were put in the way obstructing it. So it struck me that the same behavior that shut down the 72-hour truce at the onset of the war, leading to death, destruction, a failed state, was the same pattern of behavior that existed in that 7:30 meeting. That was new to me. The second thing that was new, ironically, we never did, even as Chairman Gowdy said, even have wheels turning towards Benghazi throughout the whole attack. But when it came to rescuing our Americans, realize there were still close to 30 Americans there, even with the loss of life. It was actually Libyan military intelligence officers who had been part of Gaddafi's military, who actually were in hiding in Benghazi, who actually got the heavy weapons, the vehicles, and came to rescue our people. It wasn't Libya Shield. It wasn't 17th of February Martyrs Brigade. It were these officers who we had deposed, who in a sense of humanity, I guess, came and rescued our people. Otherwise, there is a good chance they would have all been massacred. So those two were fundamental new things that I learned only by connecting the dots that Chairman Gowdy laid out there. So I would basically say to the members of the press, read it, connect your own dots, make your own conclusions, because I think that's what we're intended to do.
Are you saying, though, and make sure I understand you, that Secretary Clinton derailed President Obama's order to rescue?
I'm saying the word obstructed, because they were there to basically, the orders were given by the Secretary of Defense at 7 p.m. This meeting was convened at 7:30. We've been talking about why weren't they followed. In that meeting, if you look at it, although there was a lot of talk about the video and everybody's reporting on it, the substance of the meeting was the Department of State representatives, led by Secretary Clinton, who put all the obstacles in the way, including the need for the country clearance, all of these things. We've heard, and this is all laid out, this isn't me, I read all of this in the report, is that the Secretary had the authority to grant those right there if they were needed. And so why it then caused all the delay, why people didn't move I think fundamentally was the result of that 7:30 meeting, based on the way I connect the dots. You know, other people may connect them differently, but it was clear to me there was a meeting. She was the senior person there. The State Department threw the roadblocks up, and the direct order to deploy was obstructed and didn't happen for some 18 hours, you know, later. And that was new to me. So that's what I learned, along with all the things I learned here today. So thank you.
Were your truce negotiations mentioned in the Gowdy report?
No, because he didn't go back that far. I think they're mentioned. They were certainly mentioned in the interim report that we did 2 years ago.
Not the Gowdy report.
And I believe they're here, but he didn't go back to the beginning.
Okay.
You know, that's one of the things that this report has done is it's basically gone back, and I think Roger said put it into context. You know, so I wasn't mentioning it. To the best of my knowledge, I may have missed a word or two, but I. Okay.
Yes.
The media's reaction to the Democrats and liberals' reaction to the report released yesterday was that there's no new information, and then Clinton herself brushed it off as a conspiracy. What do you hope and predict, because obviously they're two different things, that the media, the Democrats, the liberals, and also the Republicans, how do you think they're going to react to this report today?
Largely silence. I mean, I don't think we're going to hear much about it. We should. I mean, Fox News is here. Hopefully we'll see it there. Dana Milbank was here. We kind of know what his is going to be. A bunch of conspiracy theorists got together and, you know, put on their tin hats and blah, 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 you know, as usual. I would hope. I mean, it's really an incredible report, I've got to say. And, you know, that if people read it, they will really get a clear picture of the foreign policy, of the motivations, of the ideology, you know, and what their priorities were. And how they viewed the military and the people in it. It's appalling. And I'd love to say that NBC News will be leading with this story tonight. They came to, but they're not even here, you know. I mean, and believe me, they were all invited. So.
I haven't read either report.
Yeah.
Anywhere is the video has been discussed a lot, which was the video that they said caused this whole uprising. Is anyone saying that Hillary Clinton, Ambassador Susan Rice, or the White House lied about that directly? Is that something that is said?
Yeah, absolutely they lied. There's no question. We know, again, from Judicial Watch documents obtained through the FOIA process, that the administration, including the president and the Secretary of State Clinton, were actively involved that very night while the attack was still going on, in concocting a false narrative to deflect the story from the truth and to defend at all costs, even the cost of American lives, the re-election campaign of the president. They were not even decided on which video they were going to blame. They only knew that they were going to blame a video. I don't know if you know about this, but there was another video out there created by a minister named Pastor John, and this is another obscure video on the internet, and there was discussion in the White House that night about which video, that one or the Innocence of Muslims, would be blamed for the attack on our mission in Benghazi. They settled on Innocence of Muslims, but to show you that the narrative had already been decided that it was going to be blamed on a YouTube video. And don't forget, the only person so far ever jailed, Abu Qatala is in detention, but ever jailed in connection with this debacle was the filmmaker of Innocence of Muslims, all right? And we are still waiting for any of the other principal jihadi militia leaders to be detained, to be assassinated, to be held to account. All of the people that, unfortunately, Christopher Stevens chose to work with, Abu Sufyan bin Kumu, Abdul Hakim Belhaj, people like these are still out there running around Libya, one must expect, without any accountability. So the narrative was decided in order to protect the reelection campaign of a president at the cost of American lives.
So I want to mention something else. We've talked about Judicial Watch, and they've done phenomenal work. We also have been filing Freedom of Information requests, lawsuits. Our attorney, John Clarke, is over here, and he's been working tirelessly for 3 years helping us do this. I mean, unlike Gowdy's committee, they had $7 million. We've basically done this on nothing. So nobody's made any money except John. But, yeah, Cliff.
Roger, to follow up, you know this character who was sitting behind me, Dana Milbank, you
right.
know all about
this
agenda. He asked one question of Gowdy, your reaction to the Gowdy report, and I can write the article.
Right.
Citizens Commission on Benghazi holds news conference to accuse Republicans of being in on the conspiracy that the Republicans are covering for Hillary Clinton. They're so in debt to the Muslim Brotherhood that they won't let Ted Cruz's bill come up for a vote in the Senate. I mean, you can see the article even before he writes it.
Right.
You can predict it. And that's the kind of media we deal with. I guess I'm throwing up my arms and wondering what can be done. Great for Fox News that they're here. Great that they had the Uncle Sean Smith on. But it is a tough road to hoe.
Yeah.
Especially, Clare, when you suggest that this conspiracy of the Muslim Brotherhood is so vast and goes back so far and is so deep that even the leadership of the Republican Party in the House and Senate are unwilling to tell the truth about it.
So when Pompeo was up there with Gowdy yesterday and they did release that supplemental report, additional comments, and he did come back up, and Pompeo said, yes, Hillary's actions were morally reprehensible. And so at least Gowdy didn't block them from being up there with them to say what they wanted to say. I mean, what his motivation is hard to know. But go ahead, Ace.
It's, you raise a very good point, and it's the Muslim Brotherhood penetration, which is far deeper than the communists of the 30s, 40s, and 50s. I mean, it has affected not only our domestic, but our foreign policy to a degree that you can't imagine. Where do you think all these restricted rules of engagement have come from that have caused so many of our military lives and the permanent injuries? What in effect we've done with these restricted rules of engagement is we've taken away our military technology advantage and leveled the playing field to the advantage of Al-Qaeda and the rest of the Islamic State militias. That's what we've done. I mean, this nonsense that we're going to go win the hearts and minds of a tribal society is nonsense. That's all it is. So, I mean, look what's happening today. Your immigration is out of control. This administration is seeding known Muslim terrorists throughout this country. And what did the Republican leadership do? They funded it all. They funded all of these illegal programs. And you tell me we have congressional leadership? We don't have any.
Let me say, it's almost four, but this is too valuable. I'm not going to stop it right now. We're going to go on for another 15, 20 minutes, and let's see what happens. And, James.
Okay. Fair warning, I'm going to use the T word, okay? Is there a way to get some mileage out of this by feeding this to Trump, who needs training, needs information on what's going on that he's going to have to deal with through the competition of the campaign, as well as if he does make it to the White House? Is there a way to get this information to him, so at least something can come of it, because most, as we're saying, most people are going to be wanting to bury this.
Well, I can say this. We know his top people have this. Now, what happens with it from there, I can't say. But anybody want to say anything? Yeah.
Do you think that, obviously, you mentioned that the Republicans are also covering up for Clinton in a sense. Do you think that could be caused by Trump's kind of dividing the Republican Party?
I would not agree with that premise, no. I think rather that the blame, the culpability, the dereliction of duty surrounding the Benghazi debacle is spread so far and wide across agencies, across departments, across the party aisle, and throughout Congress that many on both sides, Democratic and Republican, share culpability for what happened there. And I think they know it.
Yeah. Okay, 1 second.
Lyons, Keith Schiller, Trump's director of security, is a former narcotics detective, but also a Navy veteran. That might be the back channel to get into to see Trump. When I went to Trump's headquarters and invited him to Rolling Thunder, I went to the building and I ran into Keith, who never met me before, but I was wearing all his biker regalia, and he just put me up to headquarters, and I was able to, you know, I don't even ride, but Rolling Thunder said that very well. But anyway, my other question is as to John Brennan. If the stand-down order was given, and John Brennan, Deputy Director of CIA, is a Muslim, could he have interjected that stand-down order into the chief of station?
At the time we're talking about, in Benghazi, September 2012, John Brennan was still at the National Security Council.
Yeah,
and the Director of CIA was General David Petraeus.
Yes, okay, I'll come here next.
Hi, Faith McDonald from the Institute on Religion and Democracy. Thank you so much. My question is, in light of the abdication that didn't go through, Admiral, do you think that was influenced by R2P, that this was like a Samantha Power thing?
Yes.
Responsibility to protect the new UN doctrine of
responsibility to protect.
You want to take it, Claire?
Sure. What you're talking about is a policy theory that goes by the name Responsibility to Protect, or R2P. It has been strongly championed by Samantha Power, at that time senior advisor to the President on National Security Affairs. And the premise of R2P essentially says that if a regime, a government, is engaged in war crimes, genocide against its own people, that others in the world have a responsibility to violate the sovereignty of that state, the Westphalian system breakdown, and enter into that state, cross the border of that state in order to save those perceived to be the victims of the genocide or the war crimes. And it is this policy that Samantha Power most strongly championed within the Obama White House at that time. And yes, I think very certainly did play some role in the Obama administration decision to go into Libya. Obviously, not accounting for the very strong affiliation with the Muslim Brotherhood that led that revolution. And also, by the way, something that's not really been mentioned, but we've got it in the report, and that is very strong indications that the motivation for the president and some around him might have been ideological, certainly to do with the Muslim Brotherhood, perhaps with R2P. But the motivations of some, including the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, and perhaps some around her, including advisors like Sidney Blumenthal, was at least in part financial. they expected to reap financial benefit, lucrative deals in the wake of the ouster of Gaddafi. And that, I think, at least in some measure, motivated Clinton and some of those most closely associated with her and perhaps with the Clinton Foundation to promote the invasion of Libya, including very strong urging from Sidney Blumenthal for especially that purpose. And by the way, he headed a company that stood to gain financially from the ouster of Gaddafi.
Let me just add one other thing. There was never a humanitarian crisis in Benghazi. What was happening, Gaddafi was our ally killing the al-Qaeda militias. That was what was going on. So, you know, the right to protect really doesn't fit that equation.
Yeah, exactly.
Equation.
Benghazi was the font, the fountain, if you will, of the revolution. It's where the al-Qaeda militias like Libyan Islamic Fighting Group were headquartered. If Benghazi had fallen in March of 2011, as it was on the verge of doing, no civilian disaster, simply the defeat of the rebels at Benghazi, the revolution may well have failed. The Obama administration did not want to let that happen.
Now that I know what R2P is, I knew Right to Protect. I was just caught up on the acronym there for a second.
They use it on Sudan, which of course they've never used
I know.
Sudan.
Well, let's you know, back to Libya. What we know is when the UN resolution was being debated, it was primarily to impose a no-fly zone. We know that Samantha Powers, in the last minute before the final vote was taken, you know, stuck in language about a, you know, basically protecting people. And then they talked about the pending humanitarian disaster. Well, two things, or several things, pursuant to the law of war, a impending humanitarian disaster is not cause sufficient for one nation to attack another nation. So even if there was an impending, you know, humanitarian disaster, the action would have been in violation of the law of war. We know that the that there was no pending humanitarian disaster. But more importantly, you had asked about my truce initiative. That's why I jumped up here to respond. The truce initiative started after the bombing had started. The bombing was underway while I was doing the discussions. In the first several days of bombing, the no-fly zone had been imposed. They took out their surface-to-air missiles, and the columns of troops had stopped because that was one of the shows of good faith, so they had no pending humanitarian disaster, even the threat of. So at that point in time, there was they had fulfilled the UN resolution. In fact, the UN resolution, the first provision of it was to press for a ceasefire. And so in many respects, by throwing out the truce, not only did they attack in violation of the law of war, they didn't even follow the UN resolution. And that's what, you know, so I'm not going to comment on motivation. I'm just trying to tell you the facts. And that's why when it came time to talk about it and the Libyan business colleagues came and said, what can we do? I said, we must keep the politicians out of it. We must keep the diplomats out of it. This is something that needs to be settled by military commander to military commander. I told them about the law of war, the requirement to parley on the battlefield under a white flag if one commander. We haven't done that for a while, but it's there in the law of war, and it was well received by both sides, including Africa Command and the Libyans. And had we proceeded, you know, there's no telling where the negotiation would go. They were intended to facilitate the abdication and a ceasefire with African Union observers, but the frustration after that was that I think Admiral Lyons mentioned it. All we were asking for was 72 hours to give peace a chance, and they really wouldn't take it.
Yeah, John.
Yeah,
you want to come up? Or? Okay.
I'm not sure. I want to ask a little bit about the timing. In the FOIA suit, we've asked from the DOD all the orders, the initial orders. And we haven't gotten them. We've gotten some redacted documents, and we've got some documents, 500 pages from the DOD, but they refer to earlier orders.
Now, we just heard, I just found out, because I haven't read Mr. Gowdy's report, that the issue, that the order was given at 7 o'clock. Well, the attack began at 3, at local time. The attack began at 3:42 local time. That's three hours later. I don't understand. Maybe that's why they redacted it, because we don't know what time.
3:42 Eastern time.
Eastern time, yeah. Yeah.
Local,
right, and local time. And local time, I just understood that Mr. Panetta gave the order at 7 o'clock. Is that... And also, I read a piece out of the Gowdy's report that said that Secretary Panetta and the president said, you know, go to it, but they didn't. But they didn't do it. I mean, you can't just.
He said that at 5 o'clock. Then Panetta went back to the Pentagon, and as the report says, then the written order, you know, was issued, or the order was issued at 7 o'clock.
Well,
it took him that time between the meeting went from 5 o'clock to something, then he went back to the Pentagon, then they figured out what assets they had against him, and the order was given at 7, according to the report.
This is all nuts. Yeah. That's what John's getting at. Here, you got an attack going on, and we're going, well, let's see, we get this little order, and you know, task this guy over here, and then 3.5 hours later, we finally get something out? This is crazy.
Well, Secretary Panetta testified that he met with the president at 5 o'clock.
Yeah, 5 o'clock.
That's an hour and 15 minutes after the attack. They're fighting for their lives. An hour and 15 minutes later, he said he teed up some other issues, and then he talked about Benghazi, right. And then he went back to the Pentagon. There was no follow up questions, but that's rush hour traffic. And then he called there's something missing here. I don't know.
Let me give you the Ace Lyons theory. You know, and it's a one of the laws of self-preservation. The morning of the attack, John Tegan came over from the CIA annex, and he said to Stevens, look, you know, we know we're going to have an attack. We don't know exactly when, but we can give you much better protection if you shift your meetings to the CIA annex. Okay? I mean, the laws of self-preservation, that's what you do. Well, why didn't he do it? Well, when I was on the Lou Dobbs show, Lou said to me, what do you think happened? I said, this has all the smell of an operation that went terribly wrong. And you'll read in Pompeo's side report and Duncan's side report, they talk about, yeah, they were out to kill or kidnap Americans. And I told Lou, I said, if I had to speculate, my view is that Stevens was never to be killed. He was to be kidnapped and held hostage in exchange for the blind sheikh. And the reason being, that was Morsi's number one objective. He campaigned to be president on that. He then came to Washington the summer of 2012. It was his number one objective. We also know, I've only seen one thing on it, we know that the blind sheikh was getting ready to be moved, and then nothing. Yeah, Stephanie?
Admiral, I have a comment on that very subject, and maybe you can elaborate a little bit more. So when I read the Gowdy report, I was quite surprised to hear this in the Gowdy report. They talked about in the report the protest at the U.S. Embassy in Cairo, and before mentioning the protest in response to the Muhammad video, they actually state in the report that the protest was primarily over the release of the blind sheikh,
yeah,
and some of the Muhammad video. I never heard that in the media. It was always the Muhammad video. The Gowdy report specifically states the primary reason for the protest in Cairo was over the blind sheikh, and they were demanding his release. This is in the Gowdy report verbatim from witnesses. So,
the priority throughout 2012 was on the part of the Egyptian Morsi Muslim Brotherhood government, the release of the blind sheikh. They had been in negotiations with the White House. A delegation had actually come over to the United States and met at the National Security Council about this. The relationship between the President Obama administration and the Morsi administration was going very swimmingly at this point, and I think the Egyptian government had every expectation that they would get whatever they wanted. The Obama administration, they had them eating out of their hand. However, by September the 9th, as you'll recall, that is when the Egyptian TV talk show host first aired on Egyptian TV the clip from the Innocence of Muslims video. That is at the point, 48 hours out, when social media Egyptian Muslims, as well as then spreading around the world, began to register outrage over the video. The video took precedence. It pushed the focus on the blind sheikh out of the spotlight. And on a dime, the U.S. government also flipped from its focus on the blind sheikh to the video, because it was manna from heaven for them. It fit perfectly into the OIC, Hillary Clinton State Department agenda about criminalizing criticism of Islam. The blind sheikh could wait. He was going to get released at some point. But this took precedence because it fell in their laps.
Tom, where is this going to go from here? What do you see happening, or what should happen?
Well, not what should happen. Where it's going to go, it's not going to go anywhere. When you have both Republicans and Democrats that do not want to do it, and I hate to be so negative on it, because this is really a superb report. History will treat it well, I believe. But you have some powerful elements in this country driven and the media complicit that is not going to let this story get out, no matter all the facts that we've laid out. And again, Trey Gowdy could have really put out a gangbuster report with conclusions and recommendations, et cetera. Chuck has got another strategy he thinks he's trying to use. But the fact is I'm very skeptical with all this good work and all these facts that it's going to happen. And I think they're going for the emails right now.
Yeah. So we'll take a couple more questions. Denny, sorry.
Yeah, statement.
Okay, come on.
For starters, to emphasize what the admiral and others have said is Gaddafi and his older son took out a full-page ad in the Wall Street Journal. Is anybody here from the Wall Street Journal? Years ago, and what they had was the two of them, Gaddafi in his flowing robes and his son in secular garb, and they were discussing, and it was all in interview format, full-page ad in the Wall Street Journal about how they wanted to turn Libya into a Mecca for travelers to come. And this was years and years. This was in the, you know, I don't know how many years ago, but I remember that vividly. So, and they were dead set against it. And not only were they not, there wasn't going to be any tumultuous amount of carnage in Benghazi. There wasn't going to be any tumultuous carnage anywhere in Libya. It was very directly, as has been mentioned, and actually as I learned from this commission, Gaddafi was out there killing bad guys. He was killing al-Qaeda. And al-Qaeda, we supported. They went to Syria. They became ISIS. We developed ISIS. That's a fact. Now, to the gentleman that's sitting right there, of course, he got up and left, wanted to talk about the T word going into, I know somebody else brought the T up, but at any rate, the divisiveness between the Republicans and the Democrats there. Don't believe a word of it. I was privy in 2013, Special Operations Speaks, in support of Frank Wolf, Representative Wolf, bringing about his request for a House Select Committee, and it had to be a select committee in order to get classified information, sworn classified testimony. In support of what he was doing there in July, we came out with this Special Operations Speaks, 700 Special Operations Forces personnel signed this scroll, and we rolled it out in front of the congressional steps of the House of Representatives there. And in the lead up to that, the couple of days to that, myself and a couple other members of Special Operations Speaks went beating on doors down in the House of Representatives, which I swore I would never get into, but at any rate I did. And along with it was one of the people from our political arm. And this was a guy who was a congressional staffer, and he went over to the dark side, went over to the lobbyists. Of course, the lobbyists thought he came from the dark side. And then he came to this political media, which he saw as kind of a medium between the two, that he was still active in that. And when he left that media company, he went back into the congressional staff. But I say that only because he had a tremendous amount of background going for him. And he said of the 100 senators and the 435 congressmen, and I call those the 535 Congress critters, and you can add 10 staff to them for each one, that's over 5,000 people. That's a small city, certainly a large city in some instances. But that's a whole lot of people, and they all believe in the same percentages what this guy told me. He says 10 to 15%, and I don't believe that 15% really have the best interests of the United States of America at heart. 25 to 35% do, but, and there's a big caveat there. The 55% that remain, or however many remain, 55 to 60% that remain, are only there to stay in power, are only there to keep their others in their own party in power. They're only there to keep others in the other party in power. Think about why George H.W. Bush isn't such good buddies with Bill Clinton. Now, why would that possibly be? I don't know about that, but all I know is they're in it to keep themselves and each other in power. So Trump comes along. That's when the Republican machine that I wasn't aware of came out in full force. They're just as bad as any other political machine. So Trump has nothing to do with it except illuminating the truth, and that's a good thing.
Yes. I guess the whole time I've been thinking, what can we do to prevent this from happening again? And the only two things that come to mind, and there's your attorney over there, how can any government go back and purge records is questionable to me. Is that legal? And how can any government require employees to sign ad hoc NDAs that are not necessarily part of the federal procedures of disclosure? Are those two things, am I making this up, or it just seems like legally both of those I question.
You got to have a Congress that oversights and handles them. We don't have a Congress that has got oversight on this administration. They're both corrupt. Both parties are corrupt. Unfortunately. Yeah,
that's where we are today. That's why I say we don't have congressional leadership. It isn't there. Or you wouldn't have the out-of-control situation that you see throughout the country today.
If I might add, on the NDAs, very directly, after the fact, when somebody has come in contact with a black program, the people in charge of that program make sure anybody in contact with it signs an NDA that states they will never disclose anything that they know about that
program.
That's
legal.
That's legal.
That's legal.
Hell, that's, yeah, done. I don't know about the legality. Okay.
All right, folks. I think it's been an enlightening day, and thank you all for being here.